Good morning. We're going to talk a little bit about crime, bad things that people do that the law punishes them for, right? A crime is something that is against a law for which our country or our state provides punishment. So the question is, why do people commit crimes? It's easy enough to get along through life without taking things that don't belong to us or without hurting other people. But people commit crimes all the time. Crime rates increase every year. Sometimes rates go down, but only when we respond to crime in appropriate ways that raise the cost of crime so the benefits don't look quite as enticing to criminals. That's a very simple way of looking at crime. We call it rational choice. Rational, intelligent, making sense of the world. So not just raw intelligence, but using our intelligence to reason, to think through a situation so that we can make the right decision, or what we think is the right decision. We say that criminals make rational choices to do certain crimes. Rational choice is one of the oldest theories of crime in the field of criminology. Criminology is part of sociology. So sociology looks at how society works. That part of sociology that looks at why people commit crimes and how it affects the rest of society is called criminology. It's not very old. Almost 200 years old, that's about it. Before that, we just talked about basically philosophy. So like the PhD, the doctor in philosophy, would handle everything from chemistry to biology, anthropology, and criminology all in one. And we didn't distinguish criminology as a separate science of its own. Science is the ability to run experiments and look at the results, make analysis, develop a theory, and use that theory to construct a new experiment that will either confirm the theory or show that the theory does not make sense. There are many theories. What is a theory? A theory is a belief system that says the world works in a certain way, or a perspective. We might think of it as a pair of glasses. My prescription, my glasses, will not work for you. Probably. They might work, but only if you have the same difficulties with your eyes that I do. My eyes are not good. Oh, the world is getting a little bit dimmer every year. I'm an old man. All right, maybe not. I shouldn't say old man, but I feel old sometimes when I look and I don't see things clearly until I put my glasses on. The glasses increase the size of things around me so I can see them better. It takes away the fuzziness. For instance, if I look at a straight line without my glasses, it's not really straight. It's a little bit blurry, or fuzzy. It's because I have astigmatism. Astigmatism is a condition where your eyeball is not perfectly round. It has a little edge to it, right? Kind of like a serrated knife. A knife that might be sharp, but it bounces up and down, right? That's a serrated knife. My eyeball is like that. It's astigmatism. It's not normal. It's not a good thing. But I've had it since I was like, you know, all my life, maybe 3 or 4. So it's normal to me. Can't remember. In fact, yeah, I certainly cannot remember a time when I could not wear glasses. Well, a theory is like a pair of glasses. It helps us to see the world clearly. It's not perfect. It works if we have the diagnosis correct, if we get the correct prescription. But sometimes we get the prescription wrong. And so we have to develop a new theory or a new prescription to correct our view of the world. Well, in criminology, the first theory that came along was this theory of rational choice, using reason to make decisions. And we can attribute that to a man named Cesare Beccaria. Beccaria, an Italian dude. I'll explain more about Beccaria in the future. He's pretty cool dude. But the basics of rational choice are that every human being walks into a candy store or any other store, and we see candy and we think, it's making my mouth water a little bit, drool. I really want to eat that candy. So if I take that candy, even though I don't pay for it, what's going to happen to me? What are the costs? The costs are, well, if I get caught, I'll be embarrassed. Before I get caught, I'll run hard, and I don't like to run, right? Maybe I'll get hit or tackled for taking that candy, right? And if I have to go to court and get convicted of stealing, my family's going to hate me, my friends are going to run away. Those would be some of the costs. I might have to go to jail, and so I have a criminal record. I might lose my job. Those are some of the costs. So if I don't pay for that candy, there might be other costs. Maybe not. Maybe no one will catch me. If they don't catch me, then I get to just enjoy the benefits. What are the benefits? I get to have candy that is so sweet that would make me feel good, and I can eat it right now. And since I'm stealing it, not really paying for it, it would taste even a little bit sweeter, a little bit better. Right? Benefits? Costs. Imagine we had weights and measures, scale, and we put the costs over here and we put the benefits over here to see which one outweighed the other. If the costs are too great, then we do not commit the crime. If the benefits outweigh the costs, we say, oh, I don't mind going to jail for 3 days. I need that candy. That candy will be great. Then we will commit the crime. That's the basic idea from Cesare Beccaria, rational choice theory. Another name that we'll have for rational choice theory is classical criminology. Classical because Beccaria basically was the first criminologist. The whole idea, the whole soft science of criminology began with Beccaria. We've rejected rational choice theory now in modern days. We have lots of other explanations for why people commit crimes. And we'll talk about some of those explanations in the future. But for now, just understand that rational choice says that every human being has the ability to see, hear, smell, taste. We have the same basic 5 senses. We all have the same basic intelligence, and we can make a decision based upon the CCTV and the security and all the other things that are keeping us from stealing that candy, right? We can all make the right decision. Well, one of the biggest weaknesses with rational choice theory is that not everybody is the same. We all have different education and experience. We all make different decisions. So we would come up to that situation and even twins, one would decide to commit a crime, the other would decide not to commit a crime. They're looking at the exact same situation. They have the same information available to them. But their intelligence is different. Their education and their experience is different. Their awareness, their senses are different. So they have different value systems that impinge or change the way they use their perspectives to make decisions. So the world is not simply a matter of rational choice. Although, even though in modern criminology, we kind of reject rational choice as a scientific thing, soft science. But you and I, every day, we still believe in rational choice theory. When we hear that somebody has committed a crime, we think, oh, that person, they made that decision to do that evil thing, they need to be punished, right? We need to give them lots of costs so that they won't see the benefits of committing those crimes in the future, right? Deterrence. I'll explain deterrence more again in the future. Sometimes there's other reasons that people commit crimes, however, and it's not all rational choice. It's important that we gather from rational choice, however, the idea that committing a crime, doing anything in our life, is choice. So one of the fundamental, that means the most important elements or parts of the theory of rational choice is free will. Free, right? The ability to use my choice any way I want to use it. I'm free to do that. No one is forcing me to do one decision or another. And then will, W-I-L-L. The ability to make decisions. Free will means I can choose this, I can choose that. Here's an example of free will. If somebody holds a gun to my head and says, tell that woman that you love her. And I say, I love you. Can you believe it? Oh, no, not really. Because self-preservation says, instead of getting shot in the head, I'm going to go ahead and say whatever that person wants me to say. Right? That's not free will. If, however, there's nobody holding a gun to my head, and I see that woman and I say, I love you. That's different. Because I have used my free will, I have made a choice to say something that has deeper meaning. And if the person can tell that I mean it, those words have deep, significant meaning. Free will. Free will allows us to make decisions so that we commit crimes or so that we don't commit crimes, so that we do terrible things or we fall in love, we do great things, right? But falling in love or doing any great thing has significance only if we have the possibility of not doing those great things. We can use our will to do something other. Christianity were really big on free will. The choice to follow God, to do the right thing, to help others, to be gracious, merciful, right? Tender, loving towards others. Those are all matters of choice. Rational choice. Matters of free will. It's incredibly, incredibly important. We can look at the world and we say such horrible things have happened in the world. We had the Nazis come along and kill 6 million Jews in the Holocaust. Horrible, horrible things. Not just Jews. They killed black people, they killed gypsies, they killed people from other countries that they didn't like, that weren't of their prescribed perfect race. But the Nazis weren't the worst. The worst, they were the communists, right? When Lenin and Stalin came along, and then Chairman Mao in China, more than 100 million people were killed in order for those people to take control. Evil happened in the world. Why did God allow such a thing? Well, God didn't really allow it at all. He gave us the power to choose to do the good thing or the evil thing. And some people use that free will to do evil. It's not God's fault. It's our fault. God could have made us all robots. And if we were robots, he could program in the words, I love you. And he can program away any possibility of doing evil things. But then it would not have significance. It would not have relationship. It would not have meaning. It would be like someone holding a gun to our head and telling us what to say. We're programmed to say certain things. It's no longer of our own free will. It's no longer significant. It no longer has the meaning that those words have the potential to mean. Anything that we do is a matter of our choice. We decide to give to the beggar as we're walking down the street, the man who's crawling around on his elbows with his legs or non-legs dragging behind him. Then we can walk past and say, oh, the government will take care of him. Or we can choose to have mercy and grace and drop by just a little bit of money for him to use in the future, right? Just to eat for the day. Maybe he'll abuse it. Maybe he'll take that money and he'll go home and he'll live a very high life, drinking champagne and eating lobster every day. Right? Maybe that's his life. Probably not. If he spends 12 hours on the ground, crawling around in the dirt, pushing a little bowl ahead of him, begging for somebody to give him something, some little bit of money, that's not exactly a glamorous job. We can think it through and decide he's going to abuse my generosity. Or we can use our free will to simply do the right thing. We don't have to give everything. We don't have to give our whole wallet. Oh, I don't have my wallet with me. We don't have to give every dollar we have. That's not our obligation. But when we encounter someone in need, we do have an obligation to help them through that need, for that moment, for that day. So maybe a couple dollars, right? Each on one in Korean currency. It's not such a bad thing. It only takes a little bit to bring a smile to other people's faces, to make this world a more beautiful place. If we have that little bit, why don't we use that to help somebody else to have a better day than they're having already? All right. That's probably enough for today. Free will. The choice to do good things always carries the possibility of doing bad things. But the good things have significance and meaning because of that alternative. Enjoy your coffee. I'll enjoy mine. And I'll play you a song.
Yes, I understand every life must end. As we sit alone, I know someday we must go. Yeah, I'm a lucky man to count on both hands the ones I love. Some folks just have one, yeah, others they got none. Stay with me. Let's just breathe. Practiced all our sins, never gonna let me win. Under everything, just another human being. Oh, I don't want to hurt. There's so much in this world to make me bleed. Stay with me. You're all I see. Did I say that I need you? Did I say that I want you? Oh, if I didn't, I'm a fool, you see. No one knows this more than me. And I come clean. I wonder every day as I look upon your face. Everything you gave and nothing you would take. Nothing nothing you would take, everything you gave. Did I say that I need you? Did I say that I want you? Oh, if I didn't, I'm a fool, you see. No one knows this more than me. As I come clean, nothing you would take, everything you gave. Hold me till I die, meet you on the other side.